Press the bell icon on YouTube and don't miss another update.
The budget session of Parliament is finally over after having been extended once, and what a session it has been. This Lok Sabha has been the most productive in the last two decades, and so many legislations were actually brought in. However, this Parliament session also had the imprints of the government using brute majority and steamrolling its way through all over it. In Government Matters today, what we are going to look at is the session that was. In the studio with me, I have Moshmi Das Gupta, who tracks Parliament for ThePrint. Moshmi, as I mentioned earlier, this has been an extremely productive Lok Sabha session in terms of the number of hours clocked and in terms of the sheer number of bills that were passed by both houses. Can you give us a sense of numbers?
The Lok Sabha, for instance, Ruhi, passed 35 bills in this session, which is the highest in the last 10 years. And in terms of productivity, the House has met for 280 hours, which is 135% more than the scheduled hours.
Right.
And this again is the highest in 20 years. So, as you can see, I mean, this has been yesterday, the Lok Sabha Speaker Om Birla also said that in his valedictory speech, that how it has been one of the most productive sessions since 1952.
Right. And the Rajya Sabha, because that's the space where the government does not have a majority, and that's been a bit of an irritant for the government in the last term. So, how did the Rajya Sabha fare on this count?
So, of the 35 bills, the Lok Sabha cleared 35 bills, but 28 bills were cleared by both the houses, Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. The number of bills passed by the Rajya Sabha is a little less compared to Lok Sabha, but then in terms of important bills, I mean, most of the important bills where the government could have faced roadblock in Rajya Sabha were cleared. Be it the RTA amendment bill, be it the UAPA bill, be it the
triple talaq
bill, and last of all, the Jammu and Kashmir reorganization bill that was passed.
Right.
So that again is a very strong message that, you know, in Rajya Sabha, where the NDA doesn't have the number, so you are, you know, using your
floor strategy.
Yeah, and cobbling up numbers and passing all these important bills is a very, very strong message.
Right. And this was in fact a weakness that the government had in its first term, as I mentioned. Moshmi, also this, the 17th Lok Sabha has been special in terms of the sheer number of women MPs. So there were 78 women MPs who were elected and 300 odd first time MPs. A very healthy number of given the past, the kind of numbers we've seen of women MPs. How has their performance been? Because the speaker was keen on letting first-time MPs speak.
In terms of numbers, 94% of the first-time MPs participated in the debate, which is again a record compared to the previous sessions. And in women MPs, 96% of the women MPs participated in the debate. And the Lok Sabha Speaker, Om Birla, throughout the session, you know, he highlighted the fact that how he will give, one of his priorities would be to give first-time MPs a chance to speak, be it in debate, be it in any discussion that is happening in the House, and he kept his word.
Right. So now these are all well, very healthy statistics. As you mentioned, 94% of first-time MPs getting a chance to speak, 96% of women MPs speaking, the Lok Sabha working for the productivity being 135%, 35 bills being passed in the Lok Sabha, 28 bills by both houses, all sounds very good, very healthy. However, the big but in this session has been how the government has approached, the government's approach towards Parliament, how it has really bulldozed its way through, not sending anything to select committees. So let's first look at some of the bills that were contentious, and you know, if you can just list those 3-4 bills which ended, of course, with the J&K reorganization bill, and how the government went about it.
One of the bills which faced a lot of opposition, a lot of criticism from the opposition quarters, was a right to information amendment bill, where the power to determine the salary and tenure of the chief information commissioner is now with the, will now vest with the government.
So there was a lot of criticism that this would dilute the RTI Act because they would have to perhaps work at the behest of the government.
Yeah, right. And I mean, it was introduced in the Rajya Sabha, despite the fact that the opposition came together, it was up in arms up to oppose the bill. But in the end, the NDA government managed to sail through, and I mean, the bill was passed.
Right.
Similarly, even in the triple talaq bill, where many of the opposition parties were against it, even there, you know, the government managed to get the bill passed. And interesting thing is that when the bills were put to vote, we saw that what happened was many of the opposition parties either did not vote, abstained from voting, or staged a walkout.
Right.
So, for instance, parties like the BJD, the parties like the TRS, YSR Congress, they did not vote, or I mean just walked out. So, giving the ruling party the edge in getting the bills cleared.
Right.
In fact, that was one of the most important thing of the session was the how the opposition parties raked up this issue, and they were up in arms against how of the 28 bills that were passed by both the houses of the parliament, none of them were sent to the select committee.
Right.
A demand that they kept pressing from day one,
including for the triple talaq bill,
but the government did not relent, and it did not relent because it knew that it had the numbers and it could push the bills through.
Just to give a little bit of clarity on what Moshmi meant when she said that parties stage walkouts and or abstain from voting and that helps the government, is that when they abstain from voting, of course they're not voting against the government, and when they stage a walkout, if they're not present in the house, the overall numbers the government needs goes down. So that's how it really helps the government. So these are really clearly a flow strategy, very, very craftily worked out by the Modi government. Now, Moshmi, this session is over, and as we see, RTI Amendment Bill, UAP Amendment Bill, Triple Talaq, the J&K Reorganization Bill, very contentious bills, passed the Rajya Sabha test, which has earlier been a hurdle for this government. Looking forward, now that this government is confident that it can manage to get its way even in the Rajya Sabha, besides the Lok Sabha, where it really has a very, very healthy majority, what does it mean for the sessions going forward, and what other bills can we expect in the next few, in the next session?
So Ruhi, now that the session is over, and based on the experience that they had in the first session of the 17th Lok Sabha, you know, it gives a lot of legroom to the government to come up with whatever remaining bills which could be contentious, basically to bring that in the parliament, because now they are no more worried about not having the numbers in Rajya Sabha, because experience showed that they can cobble the numbers.
Correct.
I mean, whether, you know, friendly allies walking out, like the JDU walked out during the voting of the Jammu and Kashmir Reorganization Bill. So they know that they can get it through. So contentious bill like the Citizenship Amendment Bill can be voted in the next session of the parliament. Also, it gives a lot of legroom to the government to work on more policies and to bring or any other bill, any other legislative business with lot more ease, lot more comfort in the house.
Right. And in fact, it's also broken the myth of the so-called opposition unity, because clearly none of that was on display in the Rajya Sabha.
And it was very evident. And that how, you know, NDA, the floor strategy was so well crafted, and they had prepared. Prime Minister Narendra Modi had issued, he had told his party MPs to make it a point to be present in the house, both the houses, in full numbers, and how there was no floor planning on the part of the opposition. There was no strategy. Even in the important bills, some of the opposition parties members, MPs were missing from,
right,
in Rajya Sabha, for instance, when the Congress MPs were missing.
Absolutely.
So
right.
It was clearly evident that, you know, the opposition party doesn't has its house in order,
right,
and they did not have even a basic meeting to discuss their strategy in the house.
Right. So it exposed the weaknesses of the opposition and the strengths of the Modi government. Well, at the end of this extended budget session of parliament, what has emerged is a stronger Modi government, at least purely in terms of its ability to push legislative agenda that suits it, even if the opposition is not on board. Thank you so much for watching Government Matters.